Slav Igorov. Well, friends and non-Russian speakers call me Slava. I work in Denmark on V8 for the last 2 years. And initially I planned to call my talk One Day of Life in V8, but then it was explained to me that nobody will give me the whole day, only miserable 30 minutes. And so I had to chop it down to something much shorter and more energetic, like directly proceed to questions and answers, for example. But yeah. So, oh my God. It's pretty often that people ask me, can V8 do something? Like, here's a piece of code, what V8 can do is that. And my goal for today is actually encourage you to look under V8's hood and to understand what V8 can or cannot do, and maybe contribute something back to V8 if you see that V8 can do something better. And it's not scary, so I will try to be a fear killer by showing you some horrible machine code or something like that. And I decided to use examples of code that people sent to me in various time. And like, for example, asking what V8 can do with this multiplication of dot product of two vectors represented as external WebGL arrays. What it can do if it's just represented as, if these vectors are represented as normal JavaScript arrays, because they heard that they are less efficient in V8 than typed arrays. Or maybe a piece of horrible code like that can be found in some library like prototype, I think, where you have this constructor with an application of the initialization function. And people ask, oh, there is an apply and there is an argument. I heard they are very inefficient. And what V8 can do with that compared to the old school constructor, which just constructs an object and doesn't try to be clever. And even code like that, so some functional programmers, they ask, I like higher order functions. I like to map my reduce and reduce my map. And can V8 transform it to a native loop? Maybe. Please. And so the answer to these questions are actually pretty simple. You just need to look at the code that V8 generates. And of course you can do that. V8 does not hide it anywhere and doesn't try to, I don't know, put it somewhere on the protected data center. It runs on your computer. So yes, of course, you can look at the code V8 generates. Unfortunately, you have to build V8 yourself to do that. We don't ship it together with Chrome by default because it occupies some space. Like, there is a built-in disassembler. Who wants a built-in disassembler in the web browser? Not that useful. So, I am not going to explain what's this. You just build V8 with some options, and then you run V8 with some options, and then you can see everything that it produces, including the internal representations of the functions it optimizes. And now we will try to apply this sacred knowledge to the examples that I have shown in the beginning of my speech. So this is an example. And here, somebody who actually reads what's written in the slide can say, oh my God, what's this? It was not there. There is something, some dirty trick. What's happening? The answer is very simple. You have to force V8 to optimize your code in the sense that it does not try to optimize anything that does not occupy any measurable time in the execution of your program. Why waste an effort? And so you have to put a pressure on this function to get it optimized and to make V8 to do some work and produce some sweat. Yeah. So. And here's the questions that you should ask yourself when you look at the JavaScript code of this function is that, can V8 hoist a.lengths? It's one of the religious questions, actually, I think, in JavaScript community. Should I cache this in the local variable, or should I just write it like this? Fight. And the other question is, can array access here be as efficient as an array access in C? well, because everybody knows that arrays in JavaScript are just normal objects, and the properties have names, and arrays, they have property which is called zero, property called one, etc. And another question is that can the V8 avoid boxing temporaries produced by the computation? So V8 allocates floating point values in the boxes, and it doesn't sound very efficient. So the question is, can it avoid doing that for the local results? And the other question, which is quite similar to this one, is can V8 avoid using floating precision numbers entirely? Because here we have one variable, which is obviously an integer, and it doesn't make sense to use the whole floating point number to represent it. And here is an answer to all the questions. So I actually removed all the comments to make it fit on the slide. Actually, V8 produces more than just this loop entry comment. It actually annotates everything with, why did I produce this bunch of assembly here? Like, there was an addition, so I produced this instruction. But here I will be your comment with a Russian accent. So let's start. So this is a comparison, so conditional branch somewhere. Obviously, it corresponds to the loop condition, because we had like I less than array.length. So if we think a little bit about it, it becomes obvious that ESI contains I and ECX contains array.length. And this already answers our question. There is no load of array.length in the body, and it sits in the register, and obviously V8 somehow managed to move it out of the loop. So sometimes guys who say, or girls who say, diversity, that you don't have to cache lengths, they are completely right. Then there is a bunch of code that we can just skip because there is no corresponding JavaScript code. It was produced just to support such stuff like pausing the script execution with the pause button in the DevTools, or terminating the busy loops when some evil guy ships you a page which has while true do something. And Chrome will pop up a window that asks you whether you want to break this loop. And this is this code, so we can just skip it. This is a load from the array. You can see a bounce check. We're checking whether something is inside the bounds. So ESI contains I. EBX apparently contains the length of A. And EIX apparently contains the length of B. And then the load of these double floating point, double precision values into XMM registers. So it looks very similar to what a C compiler would produce. So you could actually ask GCC to produce the assembly and compare it, and it's pretty similar. And here is a multiplication and addition, so you don't need there are four volume Intel reference manuals, and you don't actually need them to understand that this is a multiplication. It says mal, SD. Well, SD, we can skip. Mal. So, and then there is an addition, and you can notice that D, it also sits in the register XMM2. So everything looks very nice, very tight, very compact. And then there's the loop increment. So here somebody might ask, wait a second, JavaScript is a dynamically typed language, and where is all the type checks and stuff like that? There is nothing like this in the loop at all. We just increment, load, but we don't check the types. We don't check that the array is an array. How does it happen? Well, actually, V8 moved everything that's invariant. Like, we know that A stays the same during the whole loop. So all these checks, they were moved out of the loop entirely. And if you look what's before the loop, so the number 146 kind of indicates that there is something before that. And there are a lot of stuff before that. Here is, for example, the load of lengths, array.length properties. So, and this is the magical number that allows V8 to check whether something has a certain like shape. This is called a hidden class, so map in V8. Basically, every object has this attached to it, and then you need only one instruction to say, to determine whether something has the particular type. And then if it does not have, you de-optimize. So there was a talk about multiple tiered compilation in JavaScript code before, and so you should be already familiar with this term. And then there is a load. So everything looks pretty understandable after a year or two. So, and here is the question, how V8 does that? The answer is pretty simple, tons of this text. But what this boils down to is actually that V8 observes the execution of your program somehow, and then it adapts itself and the code to this execution. So if you have stable types, stable ranges for your variables, V8 will be able to adapt the code to get the most out of the execution. Like here, V8 adapted the loop to use like WebGL load from the WebGL arrays because it have seen that these loads are loading doubles from the float 64 array. And the key thing here are inline caches. So every thing that has dynamic like behavior, dynamic lookup built in, has a corresponding inline cache in V8. And inline cache remembers what it has seen. It's the whole goal of caching. So when V8 tries to optimize this function, it will just ask the inline cache what it has seen and then specialize the code for this information. So different colors indicate like the yellow ones or whatever this is like a lookup of a property, and pink ones are like numeric operations or comparisons. And the other important moment is that V8 makes optimistic assumptions about the code it compiles. Basically, it says, okay, you used float 64 array and inline cache tells me this. I will assume that this is always true. And if this is not true, I will just, sorry guys, this will run slow, I will de-optimize. And this enables the whole, basically, this enables V8 to make the whole function fast path for the stable types and stable behavior. So if you are not stable in your JavaScript programs and your tight computational kernels are not stably typed, this is not good. I'm sorry. Okay. So here is an example of optimistic assumption which V8 makes. It does not like out-of-bounds reads from the typed arrays. It just checks the bounds, and then it does not try to handle this situation. It just goes to some address which does not even belong to this function. It goes to some deep guts of V8 to switch to an unoptimized code. And why is this the case? Why is this the case? Oh, English is a difficult language. And the reason is very simple. JavaScript has a very peculiar semantics, as you might be aware. If you do an out of bounds read from the typed array, I think you should do a prototype lookup and go up prototype chain. So you can write something like this very easily. So you can have a getter on the object prototype for the property called two. And if you make a float 64 array of a length one and look up the property two, you will get getter executed. That's why you don't want to implement this in the fast pass. It will just make the whole loop huge if you start handling these cases. And it will not allow V8 to like assume that after the load from the array, there were no side effects at all. And this basically inhibits all optimizations if V8 can't assume that. So this explains why V8 does a lot of local assumptions. Here somebody evil or maybe not so evil, moderately evil, might ask, what if I write a code like this to add a function call to the mix? And if there is a function call, V8 can't do anything because it makes local assumptions, obviously. Can I defeat V8? I want to defeat V8, oh yeah. And the answer is, no, not so simple, my friend. V8 does inlining of functions as well, so yes, it can't do anything across calls, but if it knows the target of the call, it will inline it, and the inline code will be accessible for the analysis. It will analyze, and it will see that there is no side effects and stuff like that. So that's what happens here. So the code almost didn't change because the function is inlined. But of course, if you look before the loop, then there will be a piece of code that checks that the target of the call is the same. And you can also notice that this check was moved out of the loop as well, like all other checks. So now I will try to scare away inlining. So there are constructs that V does not like because they're scary. And one of the scary constructs is with, which is all scary. And yes, it is so scary that the produced code is also scary because it scared away inlining, and V8 had to produce some pretty generic code for the loop. So instead of looking at the generated code, I encourage you, in this case, is to look at the high-level intermediate representation used during optimization. It's much less scary than the native code and much more verbose. So this is an example of this verbose stuff. Disregard files. They are coming from something called single static assignment form. And what we should pay attention to is this stuff. This is an invocation of our function called mal. And it has this scary changes square brackets star thing. It says that V8 can't assume anything at this invocation because it can change everything. And of course, V8 can't optimize anything across the invocation of this function because it knows nothing about side effects, like what will happen? What if somebody will define a property on them, like float 64 array, which also has a getter or whatever? So the load of the length property now in the loop. So V8 did not manage to hoist it out. And there is untagging, which you can disregard. And there is this strange stuff. So we call the mal function. And then it returns T46, which we then convert to double. So T46 is a boxed double. And we need to extract the double which sits in the box, take it, and then, and then actually do an addition on the doubles. So we can see that when we inhibited these optimizations by scaring away the inlining, we could not avoid boxing on the boundary of the function call, and it could not hoist out the length load from the array loop. So the advice here is that if you have a tight computational kernels, you should ensure that V8 is able to inline all the functions that you are calling these tight computational kernels. Usually it is able, but you should check that out. And some people see like maybe 10-20% improvement if they either inline by hand what V8 decided that it can't inline for some reason, or just make it suitable for inline. And this all is visible on the like high-level representations and stuff. Okay, now let's quickly go through this case. So I removed the typed arrays entirely because some people ask, we heard that typed arrays are more efficient. Yes, they were. But now we are working on enabling V8 to understand when your array contains only numbers, only doubles, and unbox it automatically. So you would not need to use verbose float 64 array, just write a normal JavaScript code. And this is I removed all the codes, left only the loads from the array. So it looks pretty similar to what we have seen in the load from typed array, but there is some strange stuff there in addition to it, like comparison is some strange constant. And this is because normal JavaScript arrays, they can contain holes. And if you load something from an index which is a hole, you have to go up through prototype, and V8 again does not support that. So for typed arrays, we know that there are no holes. But for JS arrays that were unboxed, they can still contain holes, like you can delete a property with index 2. And we don't want to convert the array. If you delete one element there, we don't want to convert it to a hash table, because this is an insanity. So we use a special non-value to indicate that this is a hole, because the NaN values are very nice. You can have different NaNs, even if you can't observe that from JavaScript. So we use a special NaN to detect that. And this is the hole NaN. OK, anyways. Yeah, this is what we do. And here one can also suggest, for example, and then submit us a change list which we will accept and land, maybe. I'm pretty sure we will. That tracks the denseness of an array, because it will have to remove these holes checks and make the loop even tighter and more concise and faster, obviously. And everybody who does computation in pure JavaScript will be happy and praise you. So please do this if you want to experience something beautiful. Okay. Now this example. There was this apply.arguments which I removed. And so I do test, which creates this new class with a class constructor, which has this.init apply these arguments inside. So can, who thinks that this can be as efficient as an old school constructor? One person. You don't believe in V8. It can be. There is no apply at all if we look at the high level representation. That's something we did recently. So there is an object allocation, then we inline the ctor function, and then we load init function, then we do a couple of checks, directly push the arguments because we are in the inline context, so we know how many arguments are there. There is no need to materialize arguments object at all, and the semantic of the apply function is known, and inline cache tells us that it's always in apply, so we can just inline everything and directly invoke the function. So yes, we can. Apply is completely gone. And this example, unfortunately, not now. So I had to include something that we can't do. Otherwise, it would look that V8 can do everything, which is obviously not true. But actually, the whole crankshaft pipeline was developed with the thought in mind that you can do all kinds of strange optimizations. And this optimization is well, kind of well-known optimization in the functional programming world when you combine several high-level function invocations into one tight loop. So if you do this plumbing, so the infrastructure is there, which allows you to say, this is the map function, this is a reduce function. And you know the semantics, so you can just transform it into a loop like that and with some additional plumbing. I can't say what's the length of the pipe that you need to stack there to do that, but it's doable. So we accept patches, as I said. I'm looking forward to see one. And there is this slide, which I will skip and proceed to the questions and answers. Thank you very much for your attention.